When it comes to the world of prototype racing, of course, these days, especially in Daytona or Le Mans style events, having a front engine or even a front mid engine layout, as Panos and Nissan have attempted, it's a relative rarity. They tend to be oddities, they're kind of oddball, wacky looking. They do tend to be crowd favourites, though. They're personal favourites of mine. The early 2000s Panos LMP1 Roadster S is one of my favourite prototypes, but you don't see it happen that often. And it's not necessarily because it's a bad idea, it's just not an altogether necessary one. Back in the day, however, especially in American racing series such as the IMSA in the 80s, even earlier in the 70s with Can-Am, you would see crazy cars being produced because of just how lenient and how great, I would say, the rule books were back then. Because they literally did the most, I would say, of any racing organization or series in history to encourage true wacky innovation. Just think of all the cars that were in Can-Am alone. The most powerful Can-Am car ever from Porsche, the Chaparral fan car, the pontoon Can-Am, which we discussed in this series, and that's probably my personal favorite episode of this entire series so far. These insane cars that more often than not didn't work very well, but they still showed great promise, and even theoretically, what they did back then could be applied to cars now and make them even faster with modern methods and technologies. Now, this particular car is not the kind of thing that many teams would take a leaf out of the book of, because this car was a total failure. Now, the vehicle is so rare that there are barely any images of it on Google, so I apologize in advance for not including many of those in the video, because there simply are not that many images of this car going around. And it's so rare as well that even the name isn't mentioned that much. I kind of had to piece together what this car might have been officially called. So for those who maybe are in the know, or maybe you've researched something that I didn't find, I would appreciate knowing if you've found the exact name of this car, but I've pieced it together as well as I could, and it's the PAS Pontiac IMSA Lights prototype. Lengthy name, so what does that actually mean? Well, PAS, the company, of course, at the forefront of the name, is Prototype Automotive Services. And this is a tiny Texas-based engineering house. They build stuff like roll cages and that sort of thing. And the guy behind the company, Jeff Beetzel, who unfortunately passed away around 2009-2010, he wanted to enter the IMSA prototype class, which way back then was called the Lights class, the IMSA Lights, or the GTP Lights. Nowadays, they're just referred to as the prototypes. Now, the rule book back then allowed you to be very, very creative. So that's exactly what he did. Now, they tried to draw some inspiration from other vehicles, in particular some of the wide-bodied Ford Mustang-based IMSA machines, which had seen success before, with the front engine layout. And he wanted to take that to the next level. And this is where the connection and the similarity to that pontoon Can-Am car that I mentioned in this series before really comes into play. Because this car uses a very similar concept. The front engine layout allows the vehicle to be very long, but also to have extremely long ground effect tunnels underneath, generating a colossal amount of downforce. You got to remember, this is still coming from a tiny privateer team. Now, the reason why the Pontiac name is in there as well is because that is where the power plant comes from. It's a Pontiac Iron Duke engine, which sounds awesome. It sounds badass. It isn't. It's actually probably the worst engine ever put into any prototype. And I can say that fairly confidently because it's a 2.4-litre, four-cylinder, with no turbo, no supercharger, from America in the 80s. That's not a great engine to be working with. Now, I'm not sure exactly how much power it had, but reportedly, the fact that this car had such a massive, a truly mammoth amount of downforce combined with next to no power and torque meant that the top speed was a mighty 110 miles per hour. That's kind of ridiculous for a prototype race car, even in 1987. You've got to bear in mind, around this kind of time at Le Mans, cars like the Peugeot P88 are literally hitting over 250. So for this car to do 110, it's slow. There's no other way of looking at it. Muscle cars going around a track will be doing better speeds than that. So you're probably thinking, how on earth could you even hope to race a prototype that can only do 110 miles per hour? Well, here's the interesting thing. The car did not do very well, and I know that's an absolute shocker. You probably didn't see that coming. Yeah, it was a total failure. The car raced twice, both in 1987. The first event was the 12 Hours of Sebring, and the second was at Riverside. And the one commonality between the two is that it didn't even qualify. In fact, at Sebring, this car was a whopping 38 seconds slower than all of the other cars on the grid. It didn't even qualify. That's insanely slow. In fact, it would be difficult to try and make a prototype that was that slow. But here's the cool thing, and this is the reason why I'm featuring it, because of course, tons of cars lose races, tons of cars don't even qualify for races, etc. So why am I still featuring such a colossal failure? A slow race car, which seems so counterintuitive. Well, the reason why I'm featuring it is because, yes, it could only do 110, but here's the cool thing. Turn one at Sebring, that left-hand turn, it's almost 90 degrees through that corner. Not only could this car do 110 on the straights, it could do 110 through that corner. So in other words, you had a car that was insane through corners, and the guys involved in it at the time, and even some of the drivers, said that it was remarkable. It was insane, the amount of grip that this car had. It was perfect through corners, but it just didn't have the straight line power. And as a result, they kept on just pulling to one side for other cars to overtake more easily. And it, as I said, didn't even qualify. So as far as being plagued, this car didn't go through some kind of financial trouble, in a general sense at least. It didn't have some catastrophic crash or a tire blowout like Toyota in the late 90s at Le Mans. There was nothing like that. There wasn't some intrigue behind the company like the MG SVR. It was just a case of a car having, on the one hand, a truly brilliant idea, but then next to nothing in terms of the engine to actually back up that idea. And that is such a shame, because a car that has the potential that this one does, it's not just different for the sake of it, it actually did work well, so well that it was insanely good through corners. It's just such a shame that the engine could not keep up. Even if they'd have used something like a Mustang engine, like a 4.6 V8, even with like 250, 300 horsepower, it would have probably still been the slowest thing on the grid, but at least it might have actually qualified. And the car would have got, I don't know, maybe 5 or 10% more recognition than it actually does. It's such a shame, because the car, I think, is an amazing little unsung hero. It's one of the most obscure cars we've ever talked about, one of the wackiest to look at. It almost looks like a drag car. It looks like it shouldn't be taking corners at all, and yet that's the ironic thing. It's amazing through corners and hopeless on the straights, the exact opposite to what the car looks like it would be good for. Now, in terms of, so ultimately, it's a car which is so rare that, as I said, you can barely find any images of it on Google. Even the name is difficult to find the exact way to say the car's name, like the car's name itself, the team, the engine, what kind of name configuration or title configuration you should give it. So hopefully I've got it right in the title of the video. But for any who are involved, of course, feel free to correct me if you know it for a fact. But overall, I think it's an amazing little idea. A car that could have done so much more. It's almost like the equivalent of taking a Peugeot 908 LMP1 car and fitting a Volkswagen Polo Blue Motion engine into it. I mean, it's not bad, but it's not exactly designed for that, so of course it's going to be slow. This did that exact same thing. You had one of the most radically advanced aerodynamic race car concepts of the time, something which was not just completely different, but actually very good, worryingly good, had it been faster, and doubtless it would have been more famous, but then fitted it with this hairdryer of an engine which just neutered its chances completely. Such a shame that it only got the chance to race twice. I'm surprised that the guys involved never actually did try to fit a larger engine, unless they did. But ultimately, I think it's a very cool little car, certainly a wacky one, and most definitely an unsung hero. Nobody talks about this car, and it deserves a lot more attention. But that's it for this pick overall. Of course, I'll see you guys next time, and you can click here on screen to see all of the previous episodes, including the pontoon Can-Am that I referenced earlier on. But for now, as always, thanks for watching.